We are not in darkness. People around us are in darkness. We do not belong to the night or to the darkness. In the Old Testament, there is this image, this picture of the current evil age as being like a night. Long and dark. And the expectation in the Old Testament is there was coming a day when the sun would rise, when the Messiah would come, when the Christ would come into the world. And we've seen that happen. Jesus has come into the world, the sun, the light. I am the way, the truth, and the light, life. All of those images that are around, there is this light that Jesus is, the light of the world.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspired biblical teaching and find out how to apply God's Word to your everyday lives. On the website you can also listen to audio versions of these programs or download them as podcasts.
So just to recap, if you're new to the series, we've been looking at 1 Thessalonians when I've been here on Sunday mornings. If you're looking for it in one of the church Bibles, we're on page 1188. 1 Thessalonians was probably the very first part of the New Testament to be written, probably written less than 20 years after Jesus' death and resurrection. And the context was that Paul, with Timothy and Silas, had visited Thessalonica to tell them about Jesus. As a result, a new church was born. However, there was some major opposition to Paul, so he had to leave prematurely, and he was unable to go back. He wanted to go back and see how this new church was doing, but he was unable to get back there, so he sent Timothy and Silas to visit the church community. Because this church community consisted entirely of new converts. So he wanted to find out, how are they doing? Are they going on with God? Have they fallen away? How is the church? And 1 Thessalonians was written by Paul to the church there in response to the news that Timothy brought back from his visit to the church. Now, I challenged you last time and the time before and the time before that to read 1 Thessalonians all the way through in one go. I talked about the fact that this is a letter. And when we get letters, you know, we don't just read a little bit and then go away for a week and come back and read another bit. You get a sense of the meaning of a letter by reading it all the way through. So, and I told you, I was going to ask you again today, how many of you have read 1 Thessalonians all the way through from beginning to end with your mug of whatever? Could you just put your hand up if you've done that? Hands right up, right up. It's getting better, thank you. If you didn't put your hand up and you come here regularly, could you put your hand up now? Just checking your hands are working. Okay, keep your hands up. I'd like to read these hands as you volunteering before we talk about Thessalonians next time, which is in 2 weeks' time, to have read it all the way through. Is that a deal? Okay, and then I will prepare to come next time, all right? Seems fair. You do some preparation, I do some preparation. Is that fair? Very good. Because you're running out of time, because next time we're going to finish 1 Thessalonians. So it's your last opportunity. So I'd encourage you to do that next time, which will be in 2 weeks' time, because I will be next week at the Men Behaving Godly weekend away. This morning's passage follows really closely on from what we looked at last time. And so I want us to take a few moments to recap last time, which was 2 weeks ago. And the subject was good news about death. Do you remember that? Good news about death. Were you here then? Yeah? But wave at me if you were here. Just really going to get some exercise this morning. You know, very good. Okay. What were the main things that we learnt last time? When we looked at that passage, the passage immediately before this one. What were the main things that we saw last time? I know it was 2 weeks ago. You can have a look back at the passage, just remind yourself. That's okay. Chris. Chris. I was supposed to pick this up. No, you're not loud enough.
That while as Christians we will be as sad as anybody else when we are bereaved, there isn't a desolation and a despair in our sadness because we have a hope.
Okay, thank you. Valentine.
That as Christians, we should live our lives, be prepared because death comes at any time.
Yeah, we should be ready because it can come any time. Yeah, very good.
As Christian, her destiny is to be with the Lord forever.
Amen. Amen. Our destiny is to be with the Lord forever. Anything else? Okay. Oh, sorry.
It's okay to mourn and grieve, but not like people who don't know God.
Yeah. It's okay for us to mourn and grieve, but it's not for us like people who do not know God. Thank you very much. And all of that leads directly into what we're going to look at this morning. So let's begin at chapter 5 and verse 1. Now, brothers, about times and dates we do not need to write to you, for you know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. While people are saying peace and safety, destruction will come on them suddenly as labor pains on a pregnant woman. They will not escape. That phrase, times and dates, is shorthand for speculating about the time for Jesus to return. All through history, well, since Jesus died, so in the last 2,000 years, more correctly, people have been trying to work out when Jesus will return, trying to calculate it so they can get that sorted. And there have been quite a number of examples of groups of Christians who've been convinced that Jesus is going to return on this particular date, in this particular month, in this particular year. And so far they've all been wrong. And the reason they've all been wrong is this. It's because God's word makes it very clear that the dates when Jesus returns will be unexpected. It is impossible to work it out. So no matter how many charts you draw up, somebody gave me, well, I haven't still got it sadly, but somebody many years ago gave me a chart of history since, you know, the whole of history and about when Jesus was going to return. I forget exactly when it was. It was some Tuesday afternoon, something or other. But they'd worked it all out and worked it all the way through. But we can't do that. And that is because God has designed it that way. It's not because we're not clever enough. It's because God has made it clear that we will not be able to work it out. The phrase, the day of the Lord, that's used here, actually has got a huge amount of baggage with it, which comes from the Old Testament. We're not going to go back and read all the different passages, but the emphasis on the phrase, the day of the Lord, is that it is a day of judgment. The day of the Lord is the day of judgment, the day when God is going to judge his enemies. And that's why you've got this references here to destruction. And the reference here to a thief coming in the night. I mean, who wants a thief to come in the night? It's not a very positive image, is it? There also is here this element, again, of unpredictability, but also inevitability, labour pains. Now, this is before, of course, the whole thing of caesareans and inducing labour and all of those things that we have today. In those days, when someone was pregnant, it was inevitable that they were going to go into labour. But it was impossible to predict exactly when it was going to happen. There is an inevitability, you know it's going to happen, but you don't know when. And what these first three verses make very clear is there is going to come a time, there's going to come a point in history when life is going along just ordinarily. It's all just happening ordinarily. It's all peace. It's all nice. It all seems wonderful. It's not there is some great climax of evil. There is some terrible thing and you think, well, you know, Jesus has got to come. Everything looks nice. It's all going very well. And then suddenly, when people are saying peace and safety, destruction comes. Because Jesus returns. I want to pause there before we go into this next verse. Now, I want to ask you this. As you read these verses, you know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. I was visiting not someone that comes to the church here recently, and asked them, they've been in their new home for a couple of years now, and I've not seen them since they moved. And I said, how are you feeling here? And they said, well, they said, you know, just after we moved here, we were burgled. So this is nearly 2 years ago. And we still don't feel safe in the house. There is that, you know, that whole thing about thieves coming in the night. There is that, it's a very powerful image. When people are saying peace and safety, destruction will come. As you listen to those three verses, as you read them, what do you feel? What comes up for you? What are you feeling?
Disturbed,
unsettled. Disturbed, unsettled. What else? I thought you're going to speak, Dennis, Matt, but you're just having got an itch. That's okay. We'll be very careful. It's like being an auction. You've got to be really careful.
Unsuspecting.
Unsuspecting.
For me, when he says to me, Jesus will come like a thief, it's like keeping me on my toes always with my love and my faith for God. Just to keep me there to be close because he can just come.
Keep me on your toes. Yeah, Fiona.
Use your time wisely because you don't know when it's going to happen, so always be prepared.
Yes, always be prepared. Denzel.
It's going to happen. No one can stop it. It's a bit like the thief is determined to get in. You have as many locks as you like, but it'll get in. So it's going to happen and nothing's going to stop it in that sense.
Okay.
I think it's a sense of since the thief is coming, you have to guard what you have, guard your belief, stay focused. On God.
Stay focused on God. Absolutely. Very good. The reason I've hung around those first three verses is that often as Christians, when we think, as we're going to in a moment, about Jesus' return, we're so focused on the fact that Jesus is coming and all the evil in the world is going to come to an end, which it will. New age is going to come in, the kingdom of God completely and fully. We just have a taste now and so on. All of those things are true. But we actually, we just skip over the reality of the huge shock that will come into our world. And the reality of judgment for people that don't know Jesus. Now, we've got the Greenford Carnival coming up in a few weeks' time. We're going to be very involved in that, and we're going to be recruiting people in the next week or two to be involved in that. We're looking for 60, 70, 80 people on the day to be involved in the various things we're going to be doing. We've got this day of prayer beforehand. Why are we involved in Greenford Carnival? Why are we doing all the things we're doing there? It's because people need to know about Jesus. And it really matters. People's destiny is at stake here. And a passage like this reminds us that time is limited as well. We think, oh, we've got loads of time. Oh, it don't matter about we don't do the carnival this year. We've got next year or the year after. Well, we don't know. We don't know. And we are required to live as if Jesus was coming back this afternoon. I've asked you the question on many occasions, and it's such a good question that I'm going to go back to it. I've asked you the question, if you knew that Jesus was coming back next Monday, tomorrow, afternoon, at 3:47, the second coming was going to take place, what would be different that you would do between now and then? And the answer to the question is there shouldn't be any difference at all. Because we should be living ready for Jesus' return all the time. All the time. Because we don't know when it's going to be. And we should be ready to meet our Saviour all the time, every moment of the day. Because we are to be people of the day. You, brothers and sisters, are not in darkness, so this day should surprise you like a thief. You are all sons of the light and sons of the day, for sons also read daughters. It's inclusive language in the original. We do not belong to the night or to the darkness. We don't know when Jesus is going to return, but it shouldn't take us by surprise, because we're ready. If you're ready for something, even if you don't know when it's going to happen, you're ready for it. You follow the logic here. If you are ready for something, even if you don't know what's going to happen today, tomorrow, next week, next month, next week, if you're ready all the time, it doesn't take you by surprise, because you're ready. And we are in the light, not in darkness. And it's an image that really doesn't work for people that live in West London. Because we're never in darkness. You know, you go outside at 2 a.m. and you can see clearly, can't you? I mean, you can't go anywhere in West London where it actually is dark. Even if you go somewhere with no street lights, you still got the orange glow that's everywhere. But remember, in the Thessalonians, the day when this was written, in Paul's day, there were no street lights. There was no gas, no electricity. There were no street lights. Outside, at night, it was dark. Some of you grown up in contexts where that is true. At night, there is no light. It is dark. I mean, there is nothing but darkness. You hold your hand in front of your face. It's hard to tell whether you've ever been anywhere really dark. You hold your hand in front of your face. You move it. You can't tell whether it's there or not. If you've never experienced that, you've never been in darkness. That's the image that's used here. Only place I've ever experienced that is the bottom of a coal mine. They said, would you like to see what darkness is like? And they turned the light out. You know, just couldn't see. I mean, there's nothing. It is darkness. That is the image that's being used here. It's that sort of darkness. We are not in darkness. People around us are in darkness. We do not belong to the night or to the darkness. In the Old Testament, there is this image, this picture of the current evil age as being like a night, long and dark. And the expectation in the Old Testament is there was coming a day when the sun would rise, when the Messiah would come, when the Christ would come into the world. And we've seen that happen. Jesus has come into the world, the sun, the light. I am the way, the truth, and the light, life. All of those images that are around, there is this light that Jesus is, the light of the world. But there are people around us who have chosen to live in the darkness. They're unaware. They can't see what's coming. It is completely dark. That's where they've chosen to live. They've chosen to live in darkness rather than welcome the light. In daylight, you're alert. In daylight, you can see what's coming. In darkness, you can see nothing. In darkness, usually, you are asleep, unaware of what is going on. It's a very strong image. Light, darkness. So then, says Paul, verse 6. Let us not be like others who are asleep, but let us be alert and self-controlled. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk at night. Let us not be like others. That word that's used, the Greek word that's used there as others in verse 6, is the same word in chapter 4, verse 13, that's used for the rest of men. We do not want you to be ignorant about those who fall asleep or to grieve like the rest of men who have no hope. It's the same word, exactly the same word. The rest of men who have no hope. Others who are asleep. When you hear the word drunk here, don't think of alcohol. That's probably not what Paul is talking about here. The image is actually a more startling image. The image is probably meaning about people who've become so intoxicated with life in the world and the way the world looks at life and sees life, they've become unaware of the reality of judgment. And you think, well, how can that be? Well, it's a great example, thinking about this in the media at the moment. All this stuff with politicians and their expenses. They began to live, not all of them, not even most of them, but a significant number of them, in a world of unreality. They become so intoxicated with the fact that they could have £25,000 for their second home. They could have this, they could have that, they could have the other. They didn't even need to provide proper receipts for things. They became so intoxicated by that, they thought that was all right. You've heard one or two MPs saying, well, everyone else was doing it, so I just thought I'd do it, as though that's an excuse. They became so intoxicated with a particular way of being that they lost sight of the fact that there was a day of reckoning coming. There's a day of judgment coming. And as the light has been shone into the darkness, suddenly they become aware of all these things that they've been doing that have been wrong. And they've stopped saying now, oh, it was according to the rules. They've stopped mercifully saying that. Got a bit bored with that, really. So when a load of them have been caught out having claimed £2,000 for their council tax, which was only £1,000, and doing it not just for 1 year or 2 years, but all the time that they've gone back that they've got the expenses claims for every year, they haven't even bothered saying, well, it was according to the rules. They've just got their checkbooks out and said, oh, we'll pay it back. But that's what this phrase is about here. It's become so intoxicated with looking at life in a particular way, you become unaware of the reality of how life actually really is. But in contrast to that, we as Christians are not to be like others, but to be alert and self-controlled. So here's the question. What does it mean for us now, 2009, all of us who are in the building here at any rate, living in West London or visiting West London, what does it mean for us to be alert and self-controlled in the context of this passage here? What does it mean for us? What does it look like? How would somebody come along, some inspector come along and look at, I'll pick on you because you're sitting there, at Chris's life and be able to say, well, we know that Chris is alert and self-controlled because we can see this. How would it be with your life? What would the evidence, if you were asked to prove that you were alert and self-controlled in the context of this verse, what would the evidence look like? What does it mean for us? Well, how should we be living? That hand right at the back there. I wasn't sure whether you were just twiddling in the air with the pencil, but it looked very much like a hand. It's a long way to the back here.
Could it mean like independent of society's behaviour? to be alert, to, I don't know, like, just...
So our values are not coming from society's values. Our values are coming from
God.
From God.
Yeah.
Yeah. Very good, Nikki. Fiona.
Our life should be exhibiting the fruits of the Spirit more than non-Christians would be. And so people would actually come out and say, there's something different about this person, and not, even if they don't know, understand how to...
Do you want to list out a few of the fruits of the Spirit?
Self-control, gentleness, kindness, love. I can't remember the rest, I'll be honest.
Okay, well, that's not bad. Yeah, very good. Just there's some here might know any of the ones in the list, so I wasn't trying to catch you out.
Not living like some people, using their credit card all the time and overspending millions or... and just
millions
being,
on their credit cards, yeah.
Yeah. Just really being excessive in the way they live.
Okay.
I think not to be careless, in the sense that the way the other divide live, they're very careless with their life. Like the Bible was using a drunken person. Take, for instance, a drunken man. The way they behave, they're not normal, so they live carelessly and say things carelessly. So as we Christians, we have to be watchful and be sober in the sense that we are not of the world, and we should be careful the way we live our life. So not to be careless is, I think, is just...
Okay, not to be careless. Very good. Joan.
Paul says somewhere else about, in Romans, not letting... the world squeezed you into its mould. Mm. And I think part of that is caring about other people more than we care about ourselves. I think that becomes very quickly obvious in a person's life.
Very good. Thank you.
That we should be alert, that is, that our life should reflect Christ, that we should live a life that is worth emulating, and to be self-control, at least to be content with what God has given us and to cherish it rather than look at others or think worldly as if, oh, this person is living this kind of life, let me go. I think it's God wants us to be self-controlled and to sort of reflect, to let our life reflect Christ.
Okay. Thank you very much. Finally, Frank.
Okay, I was going to say, we should be alert to the racism and fascism that's taking place in this country at the moment. We've just got to be aware of these things. If we're asleep and we see this rising up around us, we've got to be very careful. So we've got to be awake.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, Paul, Frank, talking about there the whole issue of the racism. It's been, I mean, we've just seen that shockingly. Those examples in Northern Ireland I talked about previously. Not today, but on a previous occasion of the way that that group of Romanians have been treated. But it's around seeing BNP councillors, seeing BNP people elected to the European Parliament, and so on and so on. And that's something we need to be alert to and awake to, because that is something which is evil and ungodly. Let's move on, verse 8. But since we belong to the day, let us be self-controlled, putting on faith and love as a breastplate, and the hope of salvation as a helmet. Now, my youngest son, Ben, was here this morning. He's still here, but you would have... that's who was playing the drums, in case you didn't know who he was. He doesn't live here anymore. He lives down in South London. And he's recently started work as a PCSO, a Police Community Safety Officer. And he's got a smart new uniform to wear, which includes an anti-stab vest. And all the time he's on duty, he has to wear the uniform. Arrives at the police station. He doesn't leave the police station until he puts on his uniform. And out he goes. So he's always ready, because he never knows when something might occur. And it's a uniform which identifies who he is and what role he has, but it's a uniform which also gives him protection. And that's the image that Paul is using here. Not of PCSO clothing, but it's the contemporary concept of the Roman soldier. who would be wearing a breastplate. A breastplate was a piece of armour which covered the whole of the front here. And it was fixed around, there was a belt around it, but it covered the whole of the front. So a bit like an anti-stab vest, only it just covered the front. Protected all the main organs from knives and swords and things of that sort. And Paul says here, since we belong to the day, let us be self-controlled, putting on faith and love as a breastplate. Now, we often hear people talking about the spiritual armour. I was reading a book last week, and this pastor was arguing that before we leave the house, before we do anything every day, we need to pray to God. I agree with that. You'd be pleased to know. But that we also need to put on piece by piece the spiritual armour. And he listed all of that. And and then he moved on to the next thing. And I thought to myself, well, that's all very interesting. I'm not quite sure, actually, that we wear the armour individually. We wear it as a body together. But that's another issue. But I thought to myself, I wonder how many people know what that means. So I thought it would be an interesting question for us to think about. What does it mean? Paul says here that we should wear faith and love as a breastplate, that piece of armour that protects the vital organs. So, church, June 2009, what on earth does it mean for you tomorrow, at work, at home, wherever it is that you are tomorrow, to be wearing faith and love as your breastplate? Because God says you should. So what does it mean to be doing it?
Hi. Somewhere else, the Bible tells us to take off our old selves and put on our new selves in Christ. So I would say that, not to contradict what that author had said, but like, it's not necessarily something that you're going to put on every morning. You can, in prayer, yeah, you can come to the Lord, but it's like your character is molded that way.
Okay, so it's about character.
Into the likeness of Christ, yeah. I don't think you can just put it on every morning.
Okay, yeah. I'll come back to you, Chris. Have a saunter down here. Should have gone around the other way, shouldn't I, really? John.
I think it's a difficult image because you've got an image of something that's external referring to something which is internal. Mm-hmm. And I think if you're going to talk about putting on faith and love, I think it's more to do with realizing that as someone who is of the day, they're things that you actually possess. Mm-hmm. So you possess faith and love, and it's in the understanding that you possess faith and love that you then move out into whatever it is. But if you don't know that you take those things with you, then it's difficult. So rather than putting them on, it's a realization of something that you've been given, and therefore to sort of sit in the truth of that and let that flow out from you.
Yeah, okay. Fiona.
Just to pick up what John said, really. It's a good idea to try and do it every day, because it's declaring to God and the world that you're actually ready to do what he wants you to do, and it gives you an open channel to hear his voice, because there's opportunities that are going to occur where he's going to want you to speak to somebody. And if you haven't taken time out at some point in the morning or in the evening to spend some time with God, you can't armour up. And it's always a good idea, because you don't know what the day's going to bring to you. And if you've got God on your side before you leave the front door, you're going to have a good day.
Okay. I want to push you a bit more. I'll come to you in a moment. Is this, what does it mean for us? How does having faith and love protect us? I mean, I agree with what John is saying. This is something that God has given us. In fact, in the Old Testament, this armour is imaged as being worn by God and is given to us by God. So we've got that. But what does it actually, how does it protect us? Is that what you're going to say, Sherry?
Not really, no.
Do you want to say what you're going to say anyway?
No, just thinking back to the breastplate of righteousness, and we don't have any righteousness of our own. the righteousness, the right way of living comes through Christ. It's Christ in us. It's his faith, his love that we want to show out of us every day. And I suppose, I guess, that brings its his protection
okay.
in itself.
Okay. I still want to push this a bit more because I want to know how this works. Yeah.
I was thinking, like, in the workplace, when you've got people that, or, you know, people that you're talking to, and you need faith to know that sometimes when the enemy's, like, you know, people might be saying things that you might think, well, I don't know, that might stop you thinking about Jesus or stop you thinking that you're a Christian, or, and you need faith to protect yourself, and you also need love to love them, even though sometimes you don't feel like loving people, and you need to, by doing that, you're protecting yourself.
Okay, so the faith that we've got, so when people do or say things that are unhelpful, are attacking us, yes. because we've got faith in God, those things bounce off. Yeah. They don't penetrate. They don't actually get into us. Yeah. They don't damage us because we've got faith. Yeah. When people around us are behaving in an unlovely way, maybe towards other people, because we've got God's love towards other people, it doesn't mean we don't retaliate. We don't hit them back because they hit us, yeah. verbally or any other way. Because we've got that love, so that love actually protects us. So what they're doing doesn't get on the inside. That's the whole thing of armour. What God has worked in us stops that stuff getting on the inside. Very good. Is there somebody over here as well? Yeah.
Yes, for me, I would say what my sister just said there is that focusing on Jesus daily, nightly, when you're awake, soon you sleep, you wake, Jesus is there. And the words. That the Bible and the words of the Bible that keeps us above all things.
Mm, very good. Lorraine.
I just feel as we go out every day, we sometimes forget that we're facing demonic powers and challenges of the day, and so we need that spiritual armour to prepare ourselves to stand up to the wiles of the devil and to be victorious.
Okay. So it is about, yes, it is... the image is on the outside, but it's actually about stuff that you can't see that is on the inside. But it protects us in the sense of stuff that comes our way doesn't damage us. One of the writers I was reading this week, Beverly Gaventa says, faith is confidence in the gospel itself. It's that confidence and trust in the gospel itself. Hope is the firm expectation of the return. Sorry, I've jumped down two lines. I'll come back to hope in a minute. Love embodies that faith in concrete actions. Faith is confidence in the gospel. Love embodies that faith in concrete actions. And so when stuff goes on around us, if we're actually in faith in God, it doesn't drag us down. When people behave in an unlovely way, we don't get sucked into that way of behaving. We're surrounded by people who are selfish. We don't get sucked into that because we are filled with God's love. So God's love and God's faith that is there in us protects us from that. Yeah? You with me? So the next image here is about salvation as a helmet. Last part of the verse, the hope of salvation as a helmet. What do you think, how does that image work for us? What does it mean, that hope of salvation as a helmet? What does that stand for us, do you think? Again, living our lives as we live our lives, that hope of salvation. What does it mean? What does it stand for us?
If we know who we are in God, we can stand. So if there is tough time at work, if you know who you are and you know everything's right with you in God, you've got the ability to stand and take what's being thrown at you, battered at you, and it's not a particularly nice situation. You can stand, and on top of that, you have the hope of knowing that there's a new day coming yeah. when it will be over and you will see what God has done in the past.
Thank you. Hope is so powerful. Now, when we find ourselves in a difficult situation, as we all do from time to time, difficult circumstances, now you look at two people facing the same circumstance. If a person does not have hope, they sink. But someone who stands there facing those same circumstances, who has hope, that hope takes them through, that hope in God. I was talking this week to a lady who has just been diagnosed with lung cancer in both lungs. This is on the back of some other cancer which she had treatment for earlier this year. And the prognosis is not good for her in human terms. And she said, well, when God's ready for me, I'm ready for him. She's just got the hope of salvation. She knows where she's going. So she's not dragged down. She's not destroyed. She's not defeated. She stands in God. She has the hope of salvation. She knows where she's going. And for us in our circumstances, having that hope of salvation, knowing that, and salvation not just meaning, not just about the fact that we're going to be living with Jesus for eternity. I mean, that is a huge thing, but not just about that. It's about the whole of our life being redeemed, being saved, that God is doing a work in us and through us. As we hope in that, and as we trust in that, that actually protects us for whatever is thrown our way. Someone else that I read this week talked about this hope of salvation is what protects us against mortal blows to our faith. I like that. As we trust, we're not destroyed. As I said previously, this armour is armour that God is in Isaiah 59:17. We're not going to read it, but you can look at it if you want to later. God is pictured at wearing this armour. So this is his armour that he has put in us. He's given us to wear. But it also reminds us that living in this age is not difficulty free. The reason that Ben wears a stab vest is because people attack PCSOs and police officers with knives. The reason we need to be recognizing this armor and using it is because life is not difficulty free. And we can't hope just to float through it all without any problems. It actually is the problems and difficulties that come our way that God works at in our lives to produce maturity. But it just reminds us of that, that living in this age from time to time is going to be a struggle. Let's move on to the last three verses we're going to look at this morning. For God did not appoint us to suffer wrath, but to receive salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. He died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live together with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build each other up, just as in fact you are doing. We're going to live together with him. We saw last time that this is our destiny. We will be, verse 17, with the Lord. Verse 17 of chapter 4, sorry. We will be with the Lord forever. Isn't that exciting? So we live in a difficult context. But God did not appoint us to fail, to suffer wrath, but to receive salvation. He died for us so that whether we are the wake or sleep is about whether we have died already. It refers back to earlier in the chapter, in chapter 4, whether we've died already, whether we are still alive when Jesus returns. Whichever state we are in, we will live together with him. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. And this is the last application question this morning. Who here from time to time needs encouragement? I certainly do. Yeah. So where does encouragement come from? Well, it comes from us as a church family. We encourage each other, don't we? Partly what we're told to do. So what does it mean for us to encourage one another and build each other up in the context of these verses we've looked at this morning? Because this is one of the ways that God gives us to encourage each other and to strengthen each other, to build each other up. So how does that work for us? What does it mean for us? Yeah, Jack.
I was watching the tennis. And
there's a surprise.
Andy Murray was winning Queens. And one of the commentators said, Andy Murray has the ability to make other players play worse than they would otherwise. And I think we ought to have, it struck me that we should be allowing, enabling other Christians around us to play better than they would if we weren't encouraging them.
Very good.
Yeah, I thought so.
I like that. I'll give you a thumbs up for that, Joan. That was very good.
I just think no matter what we go through, we know that we have that hope, and to encourage others, whatever their troubles are, just to give it to the Lord and just ask him for help and know that we will be with him in the end, and to encourage whoever, just to know that there is a God and that, that we're going to go home in the end.
Yeah, that's very good. One of the things which slaves did years ago was they used to sing songs about crossing the Jordan and being with God. A whole lot of the what we've come to call the Negro spirituals. And there are two components to that. There was a political message in that, which I won't unpack this morning. There also was a spiritual side to that, that as they sang together, they encouraged one another, that even in this horrible thing that had happened to them, the horrible circumstances they found themselves, their destiny was somewhere else. And so they encouraged each other each day as they sang these truths together. And that's a good example of what's being said here. Yeah, John. I'll go down this road this time.
Well, I like what Joan said. And I think the opportunity is even more radical than that. Because I think when we talk about encouraging one another, it's not as in that tennis match that he makes other people play worse than they otherwise would. I think the emphasis is that the more we understand about love, the more we're able to make somebody else play better than they otherwise would, and even, dare I say, better than we would ourselves. Because there's a sense in which you almost want someone else to excel beyond the point that you can excel yourself, which is quite a radical thought, because the world is full of people pressing people down, whereas we're about lifting people up. But you can only do that if you yourself feel safe. Yeah. And so instead of thinking, oh God, he's going to come as a thief in the night, what does that mean for me? I better do this, that and the other and everything. It's about saying, okay, I'm a person of the light, so therefore, what can I do for you? Or what can I do for you? And being able to escape from turning everything inwards on ourselves.
Very good. So we're called to be people of the day. And that's how we ought to be living together. Because we do not have to fear the thief in the night. We do not have to fear the coming judge. Because that coming judge is our Saviour and Lord. So, main things we've learnt this morning. Three things just to underline as we draw to a close. Jesus is going to return. Amen!
Amen!
But we don't quite know when. And that's how God's designed it. Therefore, we should be ready all the time. Amen! Didn't quite sound so sure about that. We should be living ready all the time. And our destiny is to live with God forever. Amen!
Amen.
More excited about that. I came across this quote. I want to finish with this morning. It's from Beverly Gaventa. She talked about the fact that today we have more and more sophisticated personal security. Locks, alarms, all of this sort of stuff personally. Nationally, we have so-called bigger and better weapon systems, satellite shields, all of this business. These are all, says Beverly, strategies of self-delusion. For each and every can be overturned in a moment. The gospel is the only security anyone has. Let's stand together. I'll give you a moment to make a response to God, then I'm going to pray for you as we finish this morning. Father God, I thank you for the reality of the fact that your Son Jesus is coming back into our world. I thank you that day is coming when the world as we know it is going to be wrapped up. And there will be in totality the rule of God. That day when every knee will bow, when every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is the Lord. Thank you, Father, for the hope that that gives us. Thank you, Father, for your faith you've placed within us, for the love of God that you've placed within us. Father, I ask that you will help every one of us here who's listening this morning and those watching this subsequently. You'll help every single one of us to live ready. That for us, the thief in the night is the return of our Saviour. That for us, we cannot be taken by surprise because we are living ready for our destiny to live together with you forever. In Jesus' name, amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv.